Wyoming's four distinct seasons. A natural clock set by Earth's rotation and the tilt of its axis. It's driven the cycles of all life since before the dawn of humanity. June 21st marks the solstice, the first day of summer, and the longest day of the year.
I think some of my favorite memories of summer from being a kid here, I include the long days, the late evenings, the cold nights at that time, but just the abundance of wildlife. Summer in the West is especially sweet because it's so brief. It's a short period when the water's actually warm enough to swim. But the air was clear, the water was clear. It was predictable. We knew what was going to happen in May, June, July, August, September. What happens is that summer becomes more and more critical for survival because so many species just try to get through the winter. And summer is a season of growth, a season of renewal. Now, a lot of predictability is gone. And I know it's hard to think that in one lifespan that these things would change and change in a way that indicates that it's permanent. I think from all my observations, it's here to stay.
As the sun arcs north into a clear June sky, the effects of an early spring cascade into summer, and the hottest days still lie ahead.
The glaciers have been melting steadily, and those are an incredibly important part of our late season water flow. They kick in just about the time the other streams start to dry up. So in general, it's getting drier and drier.
Fire and water are totally linked in Wyoming. The length of our fire seasons in the West has actually increased by about 76 days since the 1970s. And the reason for that is because snow is melting earlier and snow is coming later. And so as we're seeing these changes in snowpack dynamics, it's resulting in larger and more frequent fires and overall longer fire seasons. There's actually some projections that if fires increase so much in Yellowstone, that it's actually going to transform from a forested ecosystem to a grassland, and all the species that depend on the forest will also be impacted.
We're a fire-adapted ecosystem, and fire is an important component, and suppressing fires year after year is not going to keep our ecosystem in balance. We need to have some fire on the landscape.
And it actually seems counterintuitive to let more fires burn and do more prescription burning, but that actually will overall reduce future emissions by allowing us to avoid some of these mega fires.
I think in the future, fire is going to be a lot more frequent and bigger fires, and that we're going to have a lot less water. You know, I do worry as a mother that my kids will grow up in a world that's quite different than the world we live in now, and that our landscapes, our ecosystems will be different, and that people might be in conflict more over the limited natural resources. I worry that our economy is going to look quite different as well. I think there's hope if we start taking climate change seriously and start taking actions now. In Wyoming and around the world, I think we need to reduce our carbon emissions. We need to reduce the risk of wildfire in any way that we can, keep water in our streams, and keep our landscape connected.
I think there's always hope. Our hope now lies in the conservation of water. I guess my advice to the next generation or two or three would be to start learning early how to conserve.
One of the things I love is seeing that my kids think about climate change and aspire to grow up and do something about it and make the world better. And that gives me a lot of hope too.
One of the best things we can do is support policies that let nature thrive, that support big tracts of land that are intact, because as the climate changes, wildlife is gonna need to move. They might need to move north. They might need to move into the mountains. And so the more land that we can keep open and the more nature we can let thrive, the greater the world will do under the pressures of climate change.